We're going to talk about entrepreneurship, and we're going to also look at how this is going to affect our FOBs. And I'll start with definitions first. And when we talk about entrepreneurship, we ask ourselves, what is the definition? Academic definition of it. We know simply that it's just about doing business. And this is a word that has given birth to so many other similar words in the last couple of years. We had words like technopreneurship. I've had to go to do a course on that for about 6 weeks somewhere in Mozambique. Omnipreneurship, netpreneurship. We have those words coming out of the word entrepreneurship and entrepreneurship. And so we know that it's a growing word. That is a definition that keeps growing by the day. And so it's something that we can't afford to do away with. History says it's a process of creating something different with value by devoting the necessary time and effort. Assuming the accompanying financial, psychological, and social risk, and receiving the resulting rewards of monetary and personal satisfaction. Doing something new and getting a reward from it. Some form of personal satisfaction that, yes, I am doing this and I've gotten this reward. So from the word entrepreneurship, it also means that we have somebody who you call an entrepreneur. That is the person that is going to give action to that word. He is the entrepreneur. A French word which translates literally as a between taker or a go-between. Or an individual that takes risk and starts something new. Or an innovator. Somebody that develops something that is unique. You could say, oh, he brought this up. Like the prof said just now, somebody somewhere started what we call agege bread. And you discover that today, in every nook and cranny of Lagos, you have the agege bread. I'm also made to understand that somewhere in Washington, you have a Nigeria that is baking agege bread. And Nigerians love to go and buy it from there. I have not confirmed that. But I was made to understand that you have it. And so you could also be called an innovator, like I said. But the big question is, how did we come up with all this? How, for example, would you say somebody turned up to become what you call an entrepreneur, especially in our kind of environment, where the most people want to work with an institution where the only headache they want to have is the headache of collecting their salaries at the end of the month. You see, they don't want to have the headache of how does the money come? It is the headache of the CEO or whoever to bring up that money. There is what we call the entrepreneurial decision process. The kind of decision that some other person will say, oh, I am at liberty, I am free, I'm now my own boss. There is no longer the question of where have you been, what are you doing, and so on and so forth. And that entrepreneurial decision process entails a movement from something to something. That's a movement from a present lifestyle to forming a new enterprise. And what could that present lifestyle be that you want to shift from? How do you take the present lifestyle? Now, let's look at this. A change from a present lifestyle or from a kind of a work environment disruption. You suddenly wake up and discover that, oh, I'm no longer enjoying working in this place. Or I feel that I should be another person entirely. And so what is next? What do I do next? Where do I go? I want to form a new enterprise. If it is desirable, maybe as a result of the culture of the place, or the culture, acquired culture. If, for example, there is something that is done in the family, and you feel, oh, why should I let this die? If it's a culture of the family, well, let me go into it. Like I used to tell people, most of our local spices are still in the hands of mere illiterate men and women in the villages. And we cherish taking them. But we know that if we do them better with a little bit of education, they can be neater, they can be more hygienic, and they can have a more global appeal. But we abandon such culture. Then you have what we call the subculture. That's maybe old. Like they are eating bread. It's a kind of a subculture, which imposes a kind of our own local culture into bread baking, distinct from what we call the pure kind of bread baking that we acquired from the European. Then you have the family, maybe that which has been going on in the family for some time or for some years. Then teachers and peers, you have somebody teaching you and say, oh, if you like to do this, if you do this, it's going to be a good business. So you decide to move into that new enterprise. On the other hand, if there are things that make it possible for you, like government, your background, marketing, financing, and role models, something suddenly creates a possibility. Government says, oh, we are ready to give, if you have a very good business plan, we're ready to give you 5 million naira to start a new business, and you decided to jump at it. Or your background, you've chosen from your background, maybe you are an engineer by profession, and you feel there is a niche where you can develop. You quickly moved into it. Or there is a marketing opportunity. So these are the kind of things that wants to push you into becoming an entrepreneur. And the implication of the above, of all these, people coming into businesses, is that there are several businesses born in a year in the country. If you go to the Corporate Affairs Commission, either in Lagos or in Abuja, you see hundreds, you see lawyers, and you see some other people who are not lawyers, who are like agents, trying to register businesses. In a day, you talk of hundreds of businesses being filed to be registered. But some of them only live and die as ideas in the memo and article of association. As soon as you complete the registration with the memo and article of association and you give it to them, they just put it by one corner. Some of them only live for the first year and they fizzle out. Others live for a couple of years while others continue to be against all odds. All because there is the entrepreneurial process and people are choosing to go into businesses. But why is this so? Why is it that only few of these businesses survive? The big why. You could talk of our bad economic policies. Oh, government economic policies is very bad. We all agree to that. You could talk of unbridled importation of goods. I looked at toothbrush in the Nigerian market, for example. There was a day I went to a local market in Ikotun, and I looked at the number of all these malams selling toothbrushes, different types. And I did a mental calculation. Even if Nigerians obey the laws of changing their toothbrush 2 weeks, with the every 2 weeks, as the dentist will tell you, we might not need to import toothbrushes for another 1 or 2 years in the country. So the unbridled importation. Matches also, it's of recent I discovered that the matches we consume in Nigeria are imported from India. And I did some calculation and discovered that if you look at household consumption of matches in a year in the country, you are talking of billions of dollars being used to import ordinary matches into the country. All this affects small businesses. Our regular problem, the lack of electricity supply, where everybody has to generate their own electricity at a higher cost, high interest rates in the banks, the poor transportation network within the country, our bad roads, the kind of experience where you spend your, when a car spends 8 hours on the Lagos Ibadan Expressway, trailers spend 2 or 3 days sometimes. You also have this problem of lack of skilled and committed workers. We are at the point of setting up a tailoring factory, and unfortunately it went down a little bit because of some personal issues last year. And repeatedly I was told that if I want the factory to work well, I'll have to get tailors from Mali, Malian tailors. That if I don't get Malian tailors, I might not be able to run that place successfully. That if I put Nigerians there, it's going to be a big problem. So it's part of the problem we have as small businesses. And so the absence of necessary skills to navigate the extremely rough business terrain of the country is a very big problem for us. And so the truth of the matter is that regardless of all the above, a family business is still a business. The fact that a business is dubbed or tagged a family business, it is still a business. Being confronted with the problems we have mentioned earlier. Just because your brother or sister is your partner, or your son or daughter, it doesn't change a thing. You need to see them as regular partners and run the business as though they were strangers. And so to overcome this, it implies success in entrepreneurship. You must be a successful entrepreneur. Whether you are running a family business or you are a part of another business entirely, you must be a successful entrepreneur. And when you have successful entrepreneurship, it gives birth to a very good family-owned business. There is a story I used to tell and get people to laugh about, the FOB advantage. It's the race of the buffalo and the frog. Now one day, the buffalo, you know, the buffalo is a very huge animal, wanted to disgrace the frog and challenge the frog to a race. We all know that it's a fait accompli, as lawyers will say, that when the frog runs with the buffalo will definitely win the race. And so, but the frog did not want to be disgraced and racked its brain and thought and thought and thought and then came up with an idea. He has an advantage, and that advantage is that he has so many children. And so what he did was to line up the children at strategic points on the road and give them instructions and said, look, when you hear the hoof of the buffalo, just jump in front of him on the road and keep leaping on. He will overtake you. Once he overtakes you, move back into the bush and relax. And so that was that day. On that day, the buffalo had gone to invite all other animals so that they could clap for him. The referee gave the goal. Before you say they're promising, he had overtaken the frog. The next moment he saw a frog ahead of him, he increased his pace. He overtook that one. The next moment another frog was in front of him. He increased his pace and overtook that one. The next moment another frog was. By the time he got to the finishing line, he met the frog there. That's the FOB advantage. When we have a cooperative family, if along the line, if one of those frogs had seen some worms in the bush and decided to start eating, you know, the outcome wouldn't have been very good. So the FOB advantage is when we are made, when we are a family, when we understand ourselves, and when we want to leave an imprint, we can do very well. Now, I see the FOB thing can be a dangerous combination, and I'm asking, is it a dangerous combination for those of us who have been in need? Do we accept that it's a dangerous combination? Combining family and business, is it dangerous? Hello? It's a dangerous combination. Not in all cases, but it can be a dangerous combination. It can be challenging, yes. Okay, so it can be one of the most rewarding. Like I said here, if a few rules are observed. Number one, you don't hire a relation because you feel sorry for them. Oh, he's left school for 3 years now and he hasn't gotten a job. Well, and some people say, that guy, no, he's not. Just let me bring him in. It can be a big problem. If you keep family dynamics separate from business entirely, then number three, if you have a succession plan. Number four, above all, if you are all well trained and are not tired of training. If you are all well trained and you are not tired of being what? Of training. I just peeked at the prof's table when he came here and I saw a book in front of him. The book is says Execution, the Discipline of Getting Things Done. And the first thing that came to me that if prof is still reading a book on getting things done, he has gotten so many things done in life that you feel that, well, he doesn't need to read that kind of book. But he's still reading. So, and one of the biggest problems that we have occasionally again with family businesses is because people are not well trained and they don't want to be trained. Those who are well trained, they don't want to keep on training. And that's why institutions like the Lagos Business School, the Rome Business School, they are very important and they are very key to the success of businesses in Nigeria. Now, let's look at the Nigerian business terrain. The Nigerian business terrain, like the first speaker said and the prof said, is made up of FOBs in different stages of survival. Some are buoyant and doing well, some with their heads just above the waters, and some in near-death positions. While several have died and gotten buried with their founders. That's a reality we cannot run away from. And these businesses, I tried to relate over them, is that they cover areas like gas filling stations, supermarkets, estates, schools, music, arts and entertainment, manufacturing and production, export and import business, transportation, aviation, auto sales and services, agriculture, hospitals, law and accounting firms, and several others. If, for example, you look at aviation, you will remember the cargo airs of this world and remember the Okada airs of this world. Yeah, when I was still a journalist and I was an aviation correspondent, I remember then every 1 hour an Okada airplane is landing in the Muitala Mohammed Airport or taking off. Every 1 hour. But where is the Okada air today? It's a very good example. So several examples of family businesses in this area and many more areas. You talk of arts and entertainment, you remember the Bobby Basins of this world, and then well, thanks for the fellas of this world. If Obasanjo had not deployed soldiers into secondary school in those days, probably fella would not have withdrawn his son from the school. You know, fella would do Femi from school because the government deployed soldiers into schools. That was how Femi went to full-time music. Maybe he probably would have become a lawyer or a medical doctor. They are that intelligent in that family. And that would have been the end of the story. So how do we survive? Forgetting, sorry, let's just move on very fast. How do we go on and survive the situations around us? So whatever skills in entrepreneurship, in a nutshell, what are these skills? I'm talking of three: positioning skills, multi-preneuring skills, and then interpersonal skills. If we have these three skills as entrepreneurs, it becomes easier for us to survive the terrain. Positioning skill. What is positioning? What do you mean by positioning? Well, for anything to move, it has to occupy a position. That's the first thing. One of the biggest killers of businesses is competition. Do we agree with that? Many people will say, oh, it's lack of funds. That was the whole, I spent 10 years in the Lagos Chamber of Commerce and Industry. That was the rhetoric I had most. Lack of funds. But by the time you digest and diagnose and analyze those businesses, you discover that even if you give them 100 million naira in a couple of months, the businesses will collapse. Because some of the fundamentals ab initio were wrong. Positioning, because competition is one of the biggest killers of business. Two is that it starts with a product, a piece of merchandise, a service, a company, an institution, or even a person. Something has to be positioned. Either the product, either the piece of merchandise, or the service you are rendering, or the company, or the institution, or a person. So positioning is not what you do to the product. It is what you do to the mind of the prospect. And in simple words, it is about positioning your product or services in the minds of the prospect through an oversimplified message. Being the first is a positioning. It's an easy way to get to somebody's mind if you are the one doing something first without anybody harassing you in the marketplace. And many feel that to be successful in business, you must get into the mind first. But how many first can be in today's world? We are at that time when you will hardly find what you call a cranium. That's a business niche. Virtually everything is being done by everybody. So how do you reposition yourself within the competition? Because there are few craniums to fill. A company must create one by repositioning the competitors that occupy the positions in the mind. And so, in other words, to move a new product or idea into the minds of people, you must first move an old one out. That's about positioning. How? I have the orange seller story here. If I went to buy oranges in the Aluko, got there and said, ah, madam, these oranges are dirty. Why did you wash them? I said, no, no, no. Ah, we'll get time to wash orange now. So I said, okay. I said, okay, I'll come back. Keep for me 1,000 naira worth of oranges. And he went inside the market. When he got inside the market, he found washed and clean oranges and chose to buy them instead of the dirty ones. That's simply the positioning. He has, the woman selling the washed oranges had repositioned the business in the mind of that man. And so he had decided to abandon the first customer. And that's about positioning. What are you doing with your customers? Now, secondly, let's go to multi-preneuring skills. I'll move very fast. I have just about 5 minutes left. It has two definitions, the verb definition and the noun of it. It's using a variety of skills and a series of careers to succeed. And then the noun is the hottest career strategy for success in the 1990s and beyond. And why multi-preneuring? Why why is it of help she yours? Economists recognize creative destruction as a feature of capitalism. Something has to be destroyed to give way to another one. And in the capitalist system, products, processes, technologies, and industries come into being. They enjoy a lifespan and then die, only to be replaced by new ones. Some die naturally, but more often they are killed off by new developments, just like the telephone killed the telephone. So as in nature, the game in the economy becomes survivor or the fittest in the new marketplace. It becomes the survivor or the fittest. And so when you sit down on a business and say, oh, this is what we inherited in the family, this is what the family does, and you are not looking elsewhere, what will happen to you is simply the law of economics. It takes you out of the marketplace before you know it. And what are the characteristics of this new marketplace? The new marketplace has intense competition and rapid change. There is economic rationalization. There are transactions-based relationships, organizational metamorphosis, technology shifts, and individual capitalism. And with this, how do we challenge these characteristics of the new marketplace? When you talk of intense competition and rapid change, what you need to do is to develop a new sense of identity and a new set of principles. When you have competition, economic rationalization, when it comes, you have to add value constantly. When you add value, people see more reasons why they should patronize you. Transaction-based relationships. You need to acquire sales and marketing skills. It's no longer a question of, oh, it is there, they must buy it. People must drink water. That is an old story now. Number four, when you talk of organizational metamorphosis, you need to act like a producer at all times. Get it set to produce and producing the more. When you have technology shift, you need to exploit technology. You don't wait until technology overruns you. And individual capitalism, you must run your career as a business. What individual capitalism is, people can spend their money the way they like. They can, like Steve Jobs before he died, he was building a yacht, a $7 billion worth of luxury yacht. He chose to do it. That's individual capitalism. So you need to run your career as a business. Now, going to the third arm, which is the interpersonal skills. What do we mean by interpersonal skills? It is this people or soft skills which refer to the way we interact with other people, both at and away from our place of business. It's our interaction. It's different from hard skills or occupational skills, which have to do with our ability to perform certain types of activities and tasks. You see, I used to tell people on gigs, I said, look, the competence of a pilot or the pilot is a different thing from the relationship of the cabin crew, who politely tells you that, look, you may not get to your destination, and you believe in them, and you sit down gently inside the airplane. That's the soft skill. The hard skills the pilots have there. Now, it's different from hard skills. So talk about that. And I say, quoting the Bible here, the Bible says, a gentle answer turns away wrath, but the harsh word stirs up anger. And the tongue of the wise augments knowledge, but the mouth of the fool gushes folly. That's a quotation from the Bible. So why is it important to the entrepreneur? Why is the soft skill, your entrepreneur skill, why is it very important? The broader concept of it is what we call the emotional intelligence. And society encourages this as it facilitates all sorts of agreements and transactions, commercial and non-commercial, and all are tied with better health and emotional well-being of persons and businesses. The society wants things done smoothly, without hassles, without problems, and everybody is happy, and at the end of the day, we clap for one another. And how does it make you a better entrepreneur? Number one is human beings are social beings. Two, our ability to establish positive relationship have an enormous impact on our success in the different areas of our lives. And number three is, important when you are running a business and dealing with customers, suppliers, employees, investors, and others on a regular basis. You must have a good interpersonal skill. So it makes you a better entrepreneur and helps your relationship. And what are the traits that we show when you have this? One is you appear confident, charismatic, remaining calm in tense situations, ability to clearly express your thoughts and expectations, being a creative problem solver, and you are assertive but not aggressive. It said, everyone enjoys doing business with those who can get the job done.